Welcome to Space News from the Electric Universe, brought to you by the Thunderbolts Project at thunderbolts.info. On July 14, 2015, the NASA spacecraft New Horizons will achieve the first ever flyby of the dwarf planet Pluto. The much-anticipated mission is receiving international attention, and early images of the Plutonian system are already sparking some scientific discussion. Like the scientific world at large, the Electric Universe community eagerly awaits New Horizons' findings. In May of this year, physicist Eugene Bagashov offered his own analysis of the mission, as well as a few predictions of what we might expect from an Electric Universe perspective. Today, we again discuss with Eugene the Pluto investigation, including the possible early fulfillment of at least one of Eugene's predictions.
One of the most important news in the last weeks was, of course, the story about New Horizons probe entering the safe mode some 10 days before the closest approach to Pluto. I guess that makes it one successful prediction for me, because I've mentioned the possibility of New Horizons entering safe mode in previous space news on Pluto, although I was expecting it to happen a bit later and under other circumstances. Well, anyway, the official version of what happened tells us that the problem was caused by wrong timing of scientific operations. That is, the tasks were programmed in a somewhat conflicting way, or some tasks were dependent on the timing of others, which were not carried out in time. It is so-called race condition, and it could have caused the glitch in the system. Although we might think, at least for the sake of curiosity, of some other possible reasons for what happened. For example, we might look at the space weather factors. By the way, Ben Davidson at suspiciousobservers.org have already did his analysis on that topic. So, if you look at NASA's Integrated Space Weather Analysis System, ISWA for short, you can see the ENLIL model runs, showing the solar wind parameters in the solar system. There you can see that at New Horizons' location, at least two large spikes in solar proton densities should be observed this summer. The one in the beginning of June, and the other one in the second half of July, right after the closest approach of the probe to Pluto. Those spikes are to be caused by coronal mass ejections that were observed on the Sun in March and April, of course. But it is possible, in my opinion, that the mentioned timing is wrong. For example, if you watch ENLIL predictions for our planet, they sometimes mistake for a day, and in rare cases, even 2 days. Whereas CMEs only need a couple of days to reach Earth. So in case of Pluto, where it takes a couple of months for CME to reach, this error should be scaled up at least several times. Plus, we don't have much instrumentation beyond the orbit of Jupiter, so it's really hard to verify. We simply don't have enough data points. Another possibility is that the cause for these malfunctions was one of the more recent high-energy solar particle spikes that accompany some of the CMEs. The difference between those and regular solar plasma waves is that the former ones propagate much faster, roughly at speeds of 1/10 of the speed of light, and even faster. One interesting moment here is that the Dawn probe, currently in orbit of another dwarf planet, Ceres, also experienced unexpected entry into the safe mode a few days ago. And by the way, it wasn't the first time for this probe. There were a total of 3 during the last year only. And 2 of them happened at the time when the probe was using its ion thrusters. I think that might indicate that the use of electric drives such as these, with all the electric interference present in space, should be seriously reevaluated. Anyway, whatever was the reason for these shutdowns, it's really good to see that both the Dawn and New Horizons probes are awake now and doing new observations. We already have these new images of Pluto, for example. And when I look at the map of Pluto, I can't help but think about Mars. First of all, here we have very similar reddish color. This wasn't a discovery, by the way. It was well known that the real color of this dwarf planet is reddish. And as I've noted in the previous space news on this topic, there was even some additional reddening observed over time. In my opinion, it indicates that at least the surface layers of this planet are composed not only of ices, as it is supposed today, we're talking about mostly nitrogen, methane, and carbon monoxide ices, but probably of more rocky-like materials, maybe silicates. Of course, as with many other bodies, such as Ceres, Ganymede, Europa, and Enceladus, we have this hypothesis about underground ocean on Pluto, or at least that the bulk of the planet is composed of water ice. Well, in my opinion, there's not much evidence to support this idea right now, and personally, I think it is wrong. But maybe the data collected during the flyby will give some additional clues which would clarify the situation. Unfortunately, we see mostly northern hemisphere of Pluto right now, and we would have only a tiny glimpse at the southern hemisphere, when the New Horizons probe will use the sunbeams reflected from Charon to shed some light on the dark side of Pluto. I don't think those images would tell us much, considering all the factors. But anyway, what I wanted to point out is that what we can see already, and the topography that we can distinguish, pretty much resembles the topography of Mars. Namely, we have this wide dark strip in the equatorial region. It is unofficially called the whale due to its shape, and it is situated in the same area, relatively speaking, where we have the Tharsis region and Valles Marineris on Mars. And on Mars, we have this very unusual discrepancy between the northern and southern hemispheres. In the north, we have relatively low elevation and rather smooth terrain, at least on larger scale, whereas in the south, we have high elevation and high cratering. It was frequently noted by many proponents of the electric universe that this difference in the hemispheres of Mars resembles the aftermath of an electric discharge. It looks almost like the material was removed from the northern hemisphere and thrown to the southern hemisphere. If Mars was subjected to electric discharge of planetary scale, then the different polarities of opposite hemispheres would have caused exactly this type of material transport. It would be removed from the area with negative potential and transferred to the area with positive potential. Walt Thornhill, in his article Spiral Galaxies and Grand Canyons, have noted the spiral shape of Valles Marineris. This is also an indication of a possible electrical nature of these hemispheric differences. So, what I'm trying to tell here is that on Pluto we might see the same picture. Maybe the opposite hemispheres of this planet are significantly different in terms of terrain and elevation. I think this would be an important indication on possible electrical events in the history of Pluto. And we might see the same complex elevation picture in the equatorial region. Maybe this whale area actually contains some sort of canyon of its own, just like Valles Marineris, and maybe some mountains like in Tharsis region on Mars. If this would be the case, then probably the ice and ocean hypotheses of Pluto's inner structure really should be abandoned, because the icy and especially liquid interior should cause the surface layers to relax quicker to a more spherical shape, simply because of their elastic properties. But if the interior and the crust are composed of more dense and mechanically strong materials, then much bigger elevation differences would be possible to observe. And of course, the different internal composition would have serious implications towards the possible origins of Pluto and its moons. But to sort these questions out, we really need a lot of data, which hopefully New Horizons probe will provide in the coming months.
For continuous updates on space news from the Electric Universe, stay tuned to thunderbolts.info.